So good evening, everyone. Welcome to Ryan Road Elementary School and this informational meeting about the proposed solar array on the Glendale Road landfill. I'm Mayor David Narkowitz, and I'm pleased to be able to co-host tonight's meeting with Ward 6 City Councilor Mary Ann LaBarge, who is here. Thank you, Councilor, for doing this. As you know, we closed the landfill officially back in May of 2013. And after allowing time for the closure and capping and all of those processes, we've been looking at very intently at trying to repurpose the landfill and specifically exploring solar. We have a proposal after a fairly extensive process that you're going to hear about, and we have some of the key principles, including our consultant on the project, as well as officials from Ameresco, who you'll be introduced to later on to talk about the specifics of the proposal. So I also want to acknowledge that Ward 7 City Councilor Elisa Klein is here tonight as well. And we also have several other city officials, DPW Director Ned Huntley, DPW Senior Engineer David Valletta, our Building Inspector, Building Commissioner Louis Hasbrook is here. And then two city councilors have just walked in, Ward 3 City Councilor Ryan O'Donnell, and Ward 4 City Councilor, my City Councilor, Gina Louise Sierra. I live in Ward 4. So I believe I've gotten all that out of the way. I'm now going to turn the program over to our city's Energy and Sustainability Officer, Chris Mason, who's been really a key point person on this and a lot of our green energy initiatives. And he's going to introduce the panel and take it from there.
Hey, good evening. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Is this loud enough, or should we use the mic? Sounds good. Okay. So just to real quickly, just to touch base the agenda tonight, we're going to take time to hear from the owner's agent that we've hired for, Beth Greenblatt. I'll introduce her in a little more detail later on, and the Ameresco team. They're basically going to cover the procurement process that we went through, the benefits that the city sees in this proposal. We're going to allow Ameresco to introduce their team and their projects, their proposed project. And then it's farther down on the agenda, but probably might take a bit more time, I don't know. But questions and answers from the audience. It's an opportunity for you guys to ask the questions, get as comfortable with this as you can, as you want to, and maybe start bragging about it to your neighbors, I don't know, whatever. That's my best hope right there. And then the mayor will finish it off up with the next steps that the city will have to take at the end there. A few logistics. Everybody probably knows where the restrooms are, but if you don't, through the main door out there to your right and down the hall, you'll see the men's room and the women's room on the right-hand side, a little bit farther down. The mayor also pointed out a number of team members that were members of the staff that are here. Myself, Ned Huntley, David Valletta, and David Pomerantz, who's not here, the Director of Central Services, we're on the review team. And Louis Hasbrook, the Building Commissioner, has offered to be here. So when you come up with questions, it might be to the team up here, it may be the city staff. We're all here to help answer questions. There are handouts here for the PowerPoints. So if anybody wants to, there's two different sets of PowerPoints for two different presenters. If you want to walk home with the slides, they're available right here. And one last piece, I'm going to step off topic just a little bit. And if people don't know, Northampton has been awarded a team, a sustainable design assessment team that's helping us look at the next iteration of our Sustainable Northampton plan. And they've had a number of focus groups. They had a large public workshop last night where, I'm not sure how many people, 70 plus people showed up. The team was working very heavily today, and tomorrow night they're going to be presenting their findings at the Senior Center. So if anybody wants to know about that, it ties in really well with a solar array on the landfill, I believe. I thought this audience might be interested in knowing about that initiative. Okay, with that, I want to introduce Beth Greenblatt, is the Managing Director of Beacon Integrated Services, our solutions. Beth has helped us. Beth has gone through this process with a number of communities. She's helped do the procurement, vet different proposals that have come in, do contract negotiations. This is the first one the city has done. So when we set out to do this, you know, a PV array on one of our most sensitive pieces of property, the landfill, we wanted some experienced help, and Beth has done a smashing job helping us out. Absolutely. I also want to introduce the folks from Amoresco. Right here next to me is Jerry Cantor, their project development manager. Louis Aguirre, there we go, okay. The senior engineer. And then Joel Lindsay, their business development manager, who will be giving their presentation tonight. They're all up here to answer questions as well. Did I forget anything? Anybody? No? Okay, in that case, I'm going to hand it over to Beth, who's going to walk through our procurement process and touch upon the benefits that Northampton sees in this project.
Okay. Thank you, Chris. Thank you, folks, for being here tonight. Hopefully, we'll be able to answer all your questions before the much-needed rain comes and waters at least my grass. Oh.
There was one thing I just remembered as I almost walked in front of the camera. We're being recorded. We were supposed to tell everybody, you're going to be on TV, and you're going to be on website. So just so everybody knows. Go ahead, Beth.
Welcome back. I think Chris has done a terrific job in introducing myself and the team from Amoresco. I just want to make clear that I've sat on your side of the table working with the city staff in helping the city vet this process and identify the firm that will provide the best ultimate solution that meets the city's requirements and establishes and develops a project that fits within the character of the city. My firm is located in Boston, and for those of you who may remember, several years ago the city undertook a very, very comprehensive energy efficiency program, and we were instrumental in helping the city through that process as well. So I've got a lot of experience. I've spent a lot of time in the city of Northampton. It's one of my favorite places to be, particularly, sorry, but when Paradise City is here, I'm fostering your economy in a big way. Amoresco is headquartered out of Framingham, and I'll let them spend a little bit more time talking about themselves, but they are a publicly traded company, and they are also familiar. They have a project here in Northampton. They're very familiar with the city. So how did we select Amoresco? The city, as I mentioned, and as Chris mentioned, went through a very rigorous procurement process. We put out a very comprehensive request for proposals, seeking very, very comprehensive results. We received, and we did that in the end of March of 2015. So this was a process that took some time to get to where we are tonight. We received proposals from 12 firms. We winnowed that down to 4 firms that provided the best overall proposals to the city. And the best overall proposals was really structured around not only qualifications, capabilities, references, and experience, but also the overall economic benefit to the city. Wrap around that references from other projects in Massachusetts that have been done. On August 24th, the evaluation committee, as Chris just noted, met to discuss their findings, and they went through a very, very significant and rigorous due diligence process. I think we uncovered absolutely every possible stone, not only about the company, but about their design and their approach, and also the finances. On September 3rd, the city announced to Amoresco that subject to city council approval, they were selected as the firm providing the most overall advantageous solution. I know Joel is going to spend a little bit of time talking about the design, talking about their approach, talking about the process that they now need to go through in order to fully permit and construct the facility. But we have several sessions for the public, this session tonight, to talk through any questions or concerns, and Amoresco has brought some renderings. Just note, the design is not final, so these renderings are approximations of what the facility will look like, and I'll let Joel talk a little bit more about that. But there will be, I'm expecting, and I know the mayor will speak to you about the next steps for the city, there'll be 2 additional meetings, 2 city council meetings to address this particular project. So the team of Amoresco, and it is a team, one of the things that made Amoresco so advantageous to the city is that they brought together not only their own expertise, but environmental experts who have significant experience on landfills. As Chris indicated, this is a sensitive parcel, and it's very important that the city ensure that whoever they select to build something on the landfill, it has full experience and capabilities working on landfills. Landfills are hallowed ground that needs to be properly treated, because as the mayor said, it's been capped in a way that needs to be protected and maintained. The city will engage in a long-term 20-year lease of the landfill and a power purchase agreement, again, subject to city council approval, with Ameresco. 100% of the generation from this facility will be fed to National Grid, your utility, on behalf of the city. National Grid monetizes that generation and provides economic benefit back to the city for that solar energy. We're going to talk a little bit about what those economic benefits look like. The system right now in its current design is a little over 3.3 megawatts DC. I mean, it will produce about 4.25 million kilowatt hours a year. And that represents, Chris, about 25% of...
About 40%
of the overall electricity for the city. I forgot. We had energy efficiency
programs.
City
municipal.
Municipal bills for the municipal use. Yes, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
School and municipal buildings.
So all the publicly owned buildings in the city. The city will pay Ameresco for every kilowatt hour that it generates and provides the National Grid, about 7.375 cents per kilowatt hour. That number, while a firm number provided by Ameresco, may change a little, may go down a little bit, may go up a little bit, depending on some things that are completely outside of their control, and that's the cost to interconnect it to National Grid. So I think Ameresco has presented some very conservative estimates that we feel very comfortable with the economics. If the costs are lower for National Grid, the city will benefit from that in a reduced power purchase agreement price. The total benefit to the city, assuming very, very conservative estimates, and I always tell my clients that I like to be super conservative so that we underpromise and overdeliver. And so I've used costs and economic benefits from the utility that are very, very conservative and quite frankly are much lower than what the utility costs are right now. And I've assumed that energy costs will never increase over 20 years. And I think we all know that's not likely to happen. So at worst case scenario is that the economics that I'm about to talk to you about, the $7.65 million over 20 years of savings the city will see from this project, is likely very low and more likely will be in the $9 million range, assuming energy costs go up by 1% per year, which I think we would all agree is a pretty conservative estimate. So using very conservative assumptions, we're looking at a $7.65 million benefit to the city over 20 years. More realistically, it's probably closer to 9 or even greater, depending on what happens with energy costs. Remember, you're generating your own energy here at a cost that's lower than what the utility costs are to provide that energy. All good, and all consistent with your sustainability mission. In addition, Ameresco, just as a protection for the city, will post at commercial operation an annually renewing decommissioning and removal bond. So if at any time during the term, for very specific reasons, the facility needs to be removed, there's a decommissioning bond that will protect the city from having that liability, that financial liability on its own books. In addition to that, at the end of the 20-year term, the city will have some options relative to extensions of the agreement with Ameresco, or require Ameresco to remove the facility, and that bond will be in place to ensure that there's money there to remove the facility. Any questions, or do you want to move into the design? Chris, I don't know if you want to take questions.
I think it's, any questions for Beth right now? I had a feeling people were going to want to hear about the design first, so why don't we move into the Ameresco presenter.
Gotta love technology, but it works.
Yep.
thank you, Beth, and thanks, Chris. Thanks, Dr. Markowitz. We are very excited to be here. Luis and Jerry and I, this is the kind of thing we love to do. We're passionate about solar, and we like coming out and talking to people about it and helping to answer questions. As Beth said, I'm going to try to be relatively brief. I know we probably want to get more just questions and answers more than anything, but I'm going to cover some very basic things, very little bit about Ameresco. I'm going to talk about the project itself, some of the impacts, the positive impacts, some of the ways that we lessen the impact on the landfill itself, and some of the ways we ensure that the landfill maintains its integrity, and a few facts about the system and how it will operate, and also a little bit about the actual construction process and what that's going to be like. So I'm going to cover that stuff. I want to point out a couple of things, and that is, I think people have already seen, we just brought some posters, just so everybody knows what's there. Again, Beth and Chris mentioned the renderings. Those are, at this point, approximations, but they can be very useful to give people a sense of what these systems look like. Those are those two on the right. And then we did bring a couple of other poster boards, which are essentially show just snapshots from a sequence of construction of a solar facility on a landfill. And in fact, Luis, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that was Sudbury. That was the town of Sudbury that is now a complete and operating system. So I'll get started, and I'll try to be relatively quick. Beth promised to kick me if I start to babble, so we have that going for you. Ameresco. Ameresco is, as Beth said, a publicly traded company. We are an energy services company, one of the largest in North America. We are headquartered in Framingham, so not awfully far from here. And in fact, one of the things I really wanted to point out, our development team, which includes Jerry and Luis and myself, along with our design team, our construction team, our operations and maintenance team, we're all located in Framingham. And we have a real strong focus in Massachusetts in working with cities and towns. That's what we really, really are, you know, consider our wheelhouse, and that's what we love to do. And we are able to really kind of give really personal service and responsiveness to cities and towns in Massachusetts in particular with that team that's headquartered there in Framingham. That's where we all are. We do have quite a bit of solar experience nationwide and also particularly in Massachusetts. We've done a number of, we do all different types of systems in Massachusetts. We do rooftop. We do a lot of work with cities and towns and their school systems. We also have done some large ground mount systems, which means just on fields. But one of the areas where we really have found that we excel, and something that's kind of close to my heart, is doing solar on landfills. We feel it's a really beneficial use of a space that can't be used for a lot of cities and towns. And it's something that in my background in environmental engineering it really jives with what I've worked on for many years in the past, even aside from solar. We've got several projects that we've done in Massachusetts, several solar landfill projects, and this shows some of those. We've got over 5 megawatts of solar projects that are they're already built and operating. You see Lowell, Massachusetts, Acton, Braintree, Sudbury, which is the one that we have the sequence there from, and also Weston. Weston is actually being constructed right now. And Weston is similar. These are all more than 1 megawatt systems. Beth mentioned that the proposed system for Northampton is over 3 megawatts. These systems are all 1.5 to 2 megawatts. Weston is actually over 2 megawatts, so they're all of similar scale. They all have their unique characteristics, but there are some commonalities in dealing with responsibly and effectively and efficiently working on a landfill. It's certainly different than just folks that are plunking solar in open fields. So it's a very different type of operation. And just wanted to point out a few things about solar on a landfill that are in some ways common for any solar system, but also unique in terms of being on a landfill. Solar is as many of you know, is quiet. There really are no moving parts for solar. The panels themselves are completely silent. There are inverters that convert the DC power to AC power. They are very quiet. And we can talk a little bit more in detail on that later on in terms of questions and answers if people have detailed questions. We're talking about the level of a whisper or a conversation. That's how quiet they are, even from a few feet away. And it's clean. I mean, that's part of why we're passionate about it. Solar power, no emissions, no air pollutants, no impacts on water quality, no need to use water to generate energy. And that's, as many of you I'm sure know, that's some of the attractiveness of solar power. And in the case of a landfill, it's obviously a beneficial use of a large space. And as the mayor had mentioned, the city's been looking at, how can we best use the space? It's a very good way to use space in a relatively minimally invasive way. And we can talk a little bit more about that. A solar power system on a landfill is really relatively low impact, and there's certain things that we do to really enhance that, and that is really the landfill itself and the top of the landfill is not scarified, it's not resurfaced in any way. We basically can use the surface as it is, and in fact, we coordinate with DEP in terms of the permitting. And we coordinate with, in this case, would be the city and the local, the DPW and the local permitting authorities, to make sure that impact on the landfill itself and on the cap is absolutely minimized. Now there are standards that have to be followed, that DEP requires you to follow in terms of minimizing and basically maintaining the complete integrity of the cap of the landfill. So that system has to be installed in such a way as to maintain complete integrity of the cap. That's essential, and that's something that we have a very strong focus on. So really the design, as Beth had mentioned, the design right now is an initial design. That design may shift some for various reasons. It's going to go through a full permitting process locally. It's also going to go through with DEP, Western Region, with their folks, basically going through their full permitting process and getting that post-closure use permit to use a landfill for this purpose. The other thing about really solar in general that we wanted to mention is that it is low maintenance. It's a system that really requires, we had mentioned here one annual preventative maintenance visit that normally is done, just as a check. Really can be monitored remotely. We monitor this via a web-based, access system. And then there's mowing, usually once or twice a year. And we work that out with the local city or town in terms of what they are doing, what their practices are on the landfill, what they prefer, what's needed, what are the specific characteristics. Because what happens with the system is that there is still a grass surface maintained. There's not a different surface that you end up with. You have the panels, they sit on these concrete blocks, and the concrete blocks support the racking, which supports the panels. And you can see that in some of the pictures and the renderings. But that's really it in terms of that's sitting on the surface, the rest of it is grass, and so we maintain that. I wanted to quickly pull up the actual, this is actually our aerial view layout. And again, this is a preliminary layout, but it shows that we're using a lot of the parts of the landfill, basically the parts of the landfill that are sloped essentially less than 5%. So we're looking at areas that are relatively flat so that the whole system can sit on top of the landfill without any kind of slippage. That's important. So that's why you're limited to using areas that are more flat, and that means really more of the top of the landfill. And
is that the layout of the landfill with the our landfill?
Yes. This is it. Yeah.
Could you just call out on that where which road is where?
Yes.
As it relates to that.
Yeah. In terms of, well, basically, up here is north. Glendale Road is off the picture to the left.
Okay.
That's a good point. It should orient everybody. So Glendale Road is off the picture to the left. You can see the access road. I can almost use my shadow. You can see the access road. I'm like a weatherman.
No green screen.
So you can see the access road coming in here. There's also the access road that comes in through gate two, up on this side here, and then the transfer station is here. And so you can see that
a good deal of the surface of the landfill actually won't have solar panels on it, but we've used the areas in terms of our initial look at it, in terms of using the areas that are flat enough to be effective for implementation of the solar. There is another component of the array that we laid out, and it's down off the southeastern portion on the city-owned property where we added a smaller ground mount array. And so you can see off the edge of the other array that I showed, it's difficult to fit it into one picture because if we did, it would get so small, it would be very hard to see, even harder than it is now. And so this is an additional part that we included as part of the overall array. And in this case, what we put in here was just using the open area without taking out any trees or anything like that. It's just using a portion of the open area on that lot.
What are the yellow sections in that now?
That's shading. That's when we look at this, we look at what the existing trees are, we get a decent estimate of what their height is, and then we can do a shading analysis so that we can determine, okay, leaving the trees as they are, what are the areas that we can use that won't be shaded too much to be effective? Because that is something certainly the panels are sensitive to. Even if you shade one part, it can affect a larger piece of the array. Yes?
What is the total acreage that's covered?
The total acreage is, it's in the vicinity of around 15 acres. That's rough. I think it's 14 to 15 acres in that vicinity. So we did want to call out some of the real positives that we see. And you can see 4.25 million kilowatt hours of generation estimated in the first year. And I won't recite all these, but this is a significant environmental positive in terms of the input of this electricity into the grid and what you can look at in terms of the equivalent that means in terms of CO2 emissions. And that's a significant step by the city and an effective way to do it. What we have there is just basically the first year of operation and over 20 years. And the 20 years incorporates the fact that the solar panels actually have a small degradation in performance every year, about 0.5%. And that's a pretty standardized, pretty well-established amount where their performance comes down a little bit each year. So we account for that in terms of how we account for the expected output of the system. So I definitely wanted to hit this and give people a sense of what we're looking at for schedule. We're talking about, and I'm just going to cover this generally, we're talking about really getting into completing a contract with the city in the fall, then moving right into the permitting process, which includes DEP, local permitting. It also, I should mention, does include contact with Natural Heritage. There is an area near the landfill that is right now on the Mass GIS database mapped as having an endangered species. That's something we'll be looking into in more detail with our consultant, and it's something that we deal with a lot in terms of making sure that these facilities are compliant with all aspects of state regulations. So the fall, then we get into, I know that's probably a little bit hard to see, we said permitting and utility review, so we have the interconnection application that goes to National Grid. We have really that whole process taking us into the fall and into the winter, and then we're moving into, right now, looking at construction in the spring. And that is, and Beth, I don't know if you want to speak to this at all, that is also predicated on net metering capacity being established, additional capacity being established under National Grid, National Grid territory, which is something that is very much an active subject in the Massachusetts legislature right now.
Today.
It's
actually a huge hearing.
Right.
And in fact, I think in your press release, the mayor did touch on this issue of net metering. It is the facility in which the city gets its economic benefits. Again, Ameresco will feed the utility, will feed National Grid all of the electricity from the system. National Grid will take that electricity because they have to by state law, and they have to provide the city with an economic benefit based on a tariff that has been approved by the Department of Public Utilities. And it's that little piece right now that's has gone through a little bit of growing pains and is subject to several proposals at the State House right now to increase the caps to ensure that the solar industry remains sustainable in Massachusetts, and the projects that are on a waiting list right now for interconnection and the cap allocation of net metering in fact happen. So, and I think we all feel in the sort of industry, the practitioners, consultants, and municipalities all feel reasonably positive that there'll be some cap relief and we'll see these benefits accruing.
The governor testified today in favor of raising the cap.
In support of his bill,
right? In support of his bill.
Yeah, that's great.
So just got a couple more things I'm going to go over, try not to go too long. Wanted to talk a little bit about the construction process. It's going to be in the vicinity of 4 to 6 months. That's something that we have a lot of experience with. It could be as short as 4, it depends on a few things. It does also depend on the speed with which National Grid can move also in terms of their piece of the internet. We manage all the construction activities. We are in charge. We are the ones that are in charge. We basically will manage everything. We will typically have an electrical contractor. The two main contractors, subcontractors, would be an electrical contractor and a civil contractor. And we work with contractors all over the state. We're doing work in Pittsfield. Right now we're moving forward with their project. We obviously worked in the eastern part of the state, central part of the state. We like to work with local contractors whenever possible. And there, certainly with the solar that's gone on in Massachusetts, there are qualified, experienced contractors in many different parts of the state. And so we like to work with local contractors. We are going to look at that. We haven't hired our contractors yet, but that is a process that we're going to be going through. So again, this is a ballasted system, and people may not be as familiar with that term. The ballasted means it's sitting on these concrete blocks. We call them ballast blocks. And they provide ballast. They hold it down. They don't let the whole thing get blown over in the wind, so they're heavy. And so those concrete blocks are what are sitting on top of the landfill surface. No trenching, and that obviously keeps the cap intact. On the ground mount section that I showed you that's on the adjacent property, we use typically, and I think we are using for this one, we're using the ground screw system, which is something that is actually just, it's a post that actually has an auger end, and it's just augered into the ground. Very simple. It's done using a GPS locator, and it's very minimally invasive, very quick and easy, and pretty robust in terms of encountering different types of soils and even rock. We're looking at the access. We have not done this evaluation in super detail yet. That's part of the process of going forward. But access from Glendale Road, obviously we would need to be very careful to coordinate with the transfer station. with the folks at DPW, making sure that we address any operational issues, any issues in coordinating deliveries of equipment, construction, traffic. Really, these construction projects are not extremely traffic intensive. It involves, you've got the folks that are working that day, their vehicles, and they'll park them somewhere. And then you've got, basically, you've got deliveries of major equipment. That would be the racks and the ballast blocks and the panels. That typically would happen over a fairly condensed period, in a matter of a few weeks, 2 to 3 weeks even. And that would involve some tractor trailers coming on the site. So we need to work out the best way to get on. Is it, would it be better to go through gate two? Will that work? Things like that. We need to work through that. And then there's other smaller stuff that would come by box truck more periodically, but we will have, our construction manager would be working with the city and really coordinating that on a day-to-day basis to make sure that we don't have any glitches or have any negative impacts. And obviously, the work hours, you know, we don't need special work hours. We don't need special crazy work hours. We would be able to, you know, we'll comply with the mandates of the city. So that's a little bit about construction, and maybe certainly we can answer more questions. The last main thing, I think, is we are very, very high on and interested in working with cities and towns on the educational component of this. And you know, we get varying reactions, but what we've actually done is we've put together essentially a curriculum that is a whole compendium of different solar lessons and exercises that we've pulled together from various sources that are basically set up for different grade levels. So they cover all the way from first grade all the way to high school, and they're set up to be appropriate for that grade level in terms of, you know, level of sophistication, what the type of activity is, and it covers lots of different topics that are related to solar, related to renewable energy. And kind of fitting that we're here to school, I think, you know, it's something that we would be very interested in working with the city on in a way that works for, you know, the schools, the teachers, the school administration. You know, there are obviously a lot of demands that they have on them in terms of, you know, meeting the demands of the curriculum, meeting the demands of, you know, for the standardized testing that's done endlessly. And so, you know, we try to provide some things that could be made available that could maybe fit in to existing curricula that could be helpful and would be interesting to the folks in the schools. So that's a little bit about this. We really are excited about being able to offer this, and you know, hopefully that's something that we can work with the city on. That's what I had. I did include the renderings here. That's the one that's over there, and so is this, I think. Actually, this is a rendering from, this is from Glendale Road. That's Glendale Road right here. So that's looking at the main array. You can see the other array over to the right there. And then, yeah, that's actually, I think, the one that's on the poster over there. And that's also essentially from Glendale Road, but it's closer. This is a rendering, and I think this is probably in the package, the takeaway package. That is, again, this is an approximation, but this is looking from the backyard of one of the residences on Glendale Road at the ground mount system that's not on the landfill, but on the adjacent property. So it's giving you an idea of how it may look. Now, but I caution everybody to say it's not exact. It's not taken directly from the photo taken there, but it's a good approximation. And I wanted to point out that the takeaways that we have actually have some other slides in them that have some basics about solar, how it works, stuff that I didn't cover here because I thought it was going to be just too much. And so we included some of that. So not every one of these slides is in that takeaway, but there's actually some other slides that are, have some more information about solar in general.
Can I just ask you a question, Gordon? That property there, is that the Doris on Lotnick?
That's where the array is. Yes. Yeah.
I don't know who shit that is, man.
I believe someone's home. But isn't the property kind of L shape?
It is.
Yeah, so that's sort of the L of the L shape property. So to the right of the tree line.
These properties have to be.
Yeah.
Right, so it's as if it's looking at one of these properties here.
That's right. It's at ground level, looking out that way. It's actually, and then again, this is data that we pull in via aerials. And it's actually, this is probably hard to see from where you are, but this shed, it's basically looking at that.
Do you have a rendering of it with the leaves on?
We don't.
Fall and winter?
That's a good question. It is different. This is taken with the data that we have, that we're able to get from an aerial. And I'm sure the bulk of these trees are deciduous, so they are going to drop leaves, so it is different. But that's not something we've been able to do at this point, based on the digital data that we can pull in right now.
Because there'll be a different concept with leaves and without leaves, and you'll be able to, it'll be much more visible.
It will be more visible. And you know, it depends to some extent on you know whether there are evergreens, but you're right.
If I can note that line would be the north side of your lot, so the non-deciduous trees could be placed there, am I correct, that they wouldn't interfere, so that people would have a year-round view protection, if you will? That line,
I think
you're
asking basically, exactly. Could there be evergreens of some kind placed here as a visual block along this side that would not shade this?
Right.
You're right.
That's the north edge of that block.
Yeah, that's the, I'm thinking of it as the west edge.
Right.
I'm thinking so north is this way.
Yeah.
So that's why I got confused.
Right, I guess what I'm saying is if they were placed from Glendale eastward along that line, the remark about that right now there's leaves on those trees, we might be able to mitigate people's view.
Okay. Again, thank you very much, and we're certainly happy to answer more questions. And turn it back over to Chris.
No, I'm going to have you turn it over to the audience. I think this is your time to ask questions. Okay.
Hi. Telephone poles. Are there going to be, like East Hampton Landfill, you know, had to replace telephone poles to compensate for the electricity? Is that going to happen? Is that a National Grid thing that they have to? How is the telephone poles going to be situated?
It potentially could happen. It depends on whether they need to run any additional line beyond what's already there onto the property, onto the landfill. But that would come in most likely through the existing access road if it did. But that's not known for certain right now exactly how that's. You know, in terms of how that goes with National Grid, that has to be through the interconnection process.
Looking at what I had read up on the screen, what's at Spectrum and construction, and I do know because of the difficulties we had with the landfill before, traffic is a big issue. And I've already had people call me about that. They're not objecting to the landfill, but concerns about the amount of traffic. We have no sidewalks. We do have families with children and so forth. So I have great concerns about the amount of construction during the day. We have buses coming in to pick up children in the morning. We have buses that come back again to drop the children off. I have elderly people who walk that road. We have walkers with dogs and bikers. So something has to be worked out here to make sure that we do not affect any quality of life with the residents on Glendale. I think they've been through a lot before. I want to make sure that total communication, which I did talk to Chris about, which is very important.
And I totally agree. Just for my part, I'll say, you know, we're working with other towns, and often these sites are in really kind of in residential areas or adjacent to residential areas. So we have to be very sensitive about that. The one positive thing I can say is that this is not the type of construction project where we're constantly trucking in, say, huge amounts of material. You know, we don't need to use a lot of material to build the project. Mainly what we're bringing in is just the actual equipment that's going to be assembled, and that'll be all done there. And so there'll be a relatively short period of time, presumably kind of concentrated over a few days, where we would bring in, there'd be a few trucks coming in to bring in the actual equipment.
So there'll be total communication brought forth. So the people who live also, because I don't know what route you're going to be taking, we're looking at West Farms Road, which would be affected by traffic, also West Staten Road and Glendale Road. So total communication needs to come forth to these residents. Thank you.
I'm probably the most affected person in that room because I'm living right next to the entrance of the landfill. And the past 6 years, I cleared out my back lot because I knew the landfill would be closed. I want to have more light in my yard. So I'm working on to see the hill. I don't want to see actually no solar panels. Because of the reflection of the sun, might be lower my property value if I sell my property. The traffic, I was happy the landfill was closed, there are no trucks coming in and out. There's enough traffic already there. Wednesdays, Saturdays, during the week, during the day, is that gas power company runs the generator in the back, they're coming in and out. Also at night, we have the last 8 weekends, lawn mowing activities on the hill, Saturday and Sunday. So that might be either you use both gates, you know, to bring your stuff in. But the most part is I don't want to see those panels. I'm afraid my property value will go down.
I'll speak one topic, not to disregard anything you're saying, but PV panels are designed to absorb sunlight, so they actually don't glare. But it doesn't mean they won't be visible. But they shouldn't glare at the house. But I'm hearing your comment about being visible.
Being visible,
right. And I know a number of the other things that you mentioned, lawn mowing, is going to be happening. With regardless, that the landfill needs to have that or two.
Now they're mowing once a year, and it takes them 4 weekends.
Right. Okay. Well, that's
good. The weekends, I'm off.
But I hear very I hear your comment. DPW is here to hear your comment as well. That's going to happen whether a PV array goes out there or not. That's not going to change.
They want to start mowing twice a year. You know. The season is only 7 months long.
Right. Well, I think the mowing is going to be up to the DPW. I mean, that's what the landfill needs. It's a requirement the landfill needs, and in order, because you don't want the cap to be damaged, you want to maintain the vegetation on top the proper way. And again, that's really irrelevant. That has nothing to do with the PV area. But I can say that people are here. We're hearing you. So I don't know what kind of response we could provide, or I think at least you know that officials are hearing you right now.
Why are we mowing on weekends? Can't cost an extra money?
You want to address that? Sure. We have an outside contractor that does it.
Right. We have an outside contractor that we hire. He's actually local, Rich Jasky. RCW Construction on Bridge Road. He's been mowing the landfill for about 15 years, and it's work that he does in addition to his his ordinary work, so he chooses to do that on the weekends. It's not really different from a farmer mowing his fields on the weekends. It's a field. It needs to be mowed. So I basically let him do it whenever it is that it's, he feels it fits his schedule best.
Although he's receiving money for it, so I would hope that you would at least consider the needs of the residents who need to live near it and don't have a fiscal benefit to that work.
Well, he's not doing anything that's against any city ordinances. He's not starting before 7 in the morning, and he's certainly done before 10 at night. I don't believe that there's anything that prohibits him from doing the mowing on the weekends.
I think maybe we're getting off on the wrong foot. Could you possibly consider asking him if he could do it in the evenings?
I could possibly. In the evenings?
Well, no. Sunday
morning at 7 o'clock, put his brakes on right in front of my bedroom to open up the damn gate.
Yeah.
And the same on Saturday evenings and Sunday evenings when he goes out.
If somebody could just let him know that, you know, neighbors are having an issue with it on the weekends, maybe he can work out other times, I would think.
That might be possible. We need to actually put that out to bid.
Oh, to bid anyways.
So it's really going to be a question of who it is that provides the best financial benefit for the city with respect to those bids. Historically, he's been very advantageous for us in terms of a very fair price and does a good job. So we'd like to continue to use him if we can.
To build on the concerns of Councilor LaBarge about the traffic during the construction period, I'm wondering if we could make a request that's pretty basic and simple just to alter the routes of the tractor trailers so that they're coming from different directions, so that it's not exactly the same route this every time. It's just one way that I know of with construction projects we can kind of lessen the impact of the traffic to the people in a particular place. I mean, they can come from the other direction, maybe around, like different things like that.
I work in the design of the project and also work with the construction engineers and the construction managers. And the truth is that the equipment doesn't come at the same days. I mean, it's the panels, the racking, the ballast block, they are spread. And they, I mean, the panels come for one day or 2 days, 3 days, and then, so it's not all at the same time. So it's going to be a spread through maybe 2-3 weeks that you don't see, I mean, just 10 trucks the same day. That's not the case. But we work with the city to do a schedule and because we know exactly when the equipment is coming. So we can plan and see, and we know how many trucks are coming. I mean, we can work with the city and maybe try to use different routes.
We can publish a schedule, we can do robocalls, we have the ability to do a lot of different ways.
And that's what you're talking.
The communication.
Louis has the building commissioner for North Hampton, also the building commissioner in Williamsburg, and they did a fairly large ground-mounted solar array, and the amount of traffic compared to the size of the project was minimal. A small fraction of what you would see in a multi-story building, scarcely more than a half a dozen houses. And the amount of materials in a pile is probably not more than 10 tractor trailers. And the site work is especially on top of landfill is minimal. They don't dig holes, they set something down. So there's not bulldozers, there'll be some concrete trucks. But I honestly believe that for the amount of money invested in the project, the amount of activity was really quite minimal. And you know, I don't say that lightly. I mean, I'll be here and I'll be the one who takes the calls about traffic because it's part of the zoning issue.
In terms of the net metering caps, is this deal with the city based on getting those caps, or is it, hopefully it's coming soon? If it isn't, what changes and how much changes?
very good question, and in fact, that was part of the due diligence that the city did with each of the firms that it interviewed. The best economic benefit, obviously, is if the net metering caps, if there's relief to the caps, because we get the full retail rate of electricity. And just to give you sort of a sense of what that means, very conservatively, for every kilowatt hour that these guys send to National Grid, National Grid's going to pay the city, let's just say, 16.5 cents. If there's no net metering, then that economic benefit changes to the city. And so we pursued with Ameresco, as part of the due diligence process, the possibility of entering into potentially some alternative arrangement, whether they lease the landfill and provide the generation into the wholesale market. And that will clearly change the economic benefit to the city. And that's something that the city will have to evaluate before it says yes. So the premise right now for this contract and for the benefits is that there is cap relief for net metering, and we'll be able to get those very attractive economic benefits from National Grid. If that does not happen, and we will know that before they start construction, we'll be able to do, the contract will provide for lack of a better term, exit ramps for both parties. So we're being very mindful of the regulatory environment and the impact it has on the economics of these projects.
Question. Hearing one of my residents, which he does, about the landfill, and him looking at the panels, and you've done how many landfills? 5, I think it is, that you've constructed? Is it 5 or 7?
We have 4 or 5 in operation, and we are constructing about 3.
Are they into residential, like on Glendale Road?
Some of them, like Weston, yeah.
And if somebody had property like he has and has the visibility of seeing the panels, have their homes depreciated?
So
do you know that?
I can tell you what the Department of Energy Resources has said.
Okay.
Take it for what it's worth. There is no empirical data that shows the property values have decreased, whatever that means. But there is no data that supports that. I think the goal is, to the best of our ability in the design and in the screening, to try to minimize some of those impacts. But absolutely, if it's up on a cap and you're down on the ground and you're looking up, you'll see it. If you're down on the western side of it, you'll see the side of the panels. You won't see them face on. But you will, you know, if you're looking all the way up on the cap, you'll see them.
I'm a little concerned because we do have possibly a development coming through with 28 homes, 27 to 28 homes. So I was curious about this.
I mean, there's no empirical data on that. I mean,
I'm saying solar on a house has been shown to increase its value.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah.
I have a question. Is the city buying this system? I mean, they're getting the money for the net metering. Who's applying? I mean, where's the finance?
So the city is entering into, as I mentioned, a 20-year lease,
right,
and power purchase agreement to buy the output of the system.
So they're buying
Ameresco
the energy from, and you're just saying it's going to be produced at a lower rate than it would normally. That's where the income is coming.
That is correct.
Okay.
And Ameresco would own the asset and maintain it and operate it and ensure it and all of that stuff.
And Beth, isn't that key also in terms of accessing the federal energy credit? Because the city, if the city owned the system, we would not be eligible for the almost one-third federal energy credit.
That's exactly,
which is why
right,
many of these are lease deals, including Smith College and, you know, any
correct,
lots of other institutions
correct,
do them as lease deals.
I'm actually working with, you know, probably 12.5 municipalities who are turning their landfills from cost centers into profit centers, which are helping to provide additional revenue streams into the municipality. Because as Joel said, there's nothing else you can use the landfills for. All of my clients are doing them under what's called these power purchase agreements. And the reason for that, as the mayor has indicated, is there's an economic benefit, a federal tax credit, that non-tax-paying entities, tax-exempt entities, can't fully utilize. Plus, there's accelerated depreciation. So there's a variety of different financial incentives that helps them reduce their cost, which they're passing back to the city in a lower cost per kilowatt hour.
And I also think hearing at 40% of that energy is going to go to the city, and you're looking at our schools and our municipal buildings. That's taxpayers saving money here, and that's what I'm looking at.
And it's significant, to be honest with you. Some of your neighbors in the local community who served by Western Mass Electric has now, Eversource has a very, very different rate structure, and the economic benefits of these projects to them are significantly lower than behind National Grid. So the good news is you may be paying more on a per kilowatt hour basis, but because of that, you're getting back much greater benefits. And National Grid isn't doing it out of the kindness of their heart. They're required to do it by state law.
Right, they're designed to absorb light. That's what they want to do.
I just want to point out that I'm assuming that the frames also, something is applied to them to sort of mitigate glare. Is that correct?
Yeah, the frame is aluminum. It's not a glossy material. It's aluminum. It oxidizes a little bit, so there is no reflection really from the aluminum.
Okay.
Yeah.
I want to really thank whoever put this together, that the decommissioning process is taken care of and sort of protects the town, because I understand that it's their end of life that can pose some hazards. I would just ask that we pay attention to making sure that our emergency responders have whatever equipment they need to handle a natural disaster, a fire on premises, or something before we end up with a problem. I don't know if that's something that 252 pages of your proposal, I get to skim through some of them. But I just want to make sure that our individuals, our neighbors, who are that person.
Yeah, let me respond to that just real briefly. our fire department actually may have this training already, but there is, and it's not just for PV on a landfill.
Okay.
It's probably more important because people have PVs on their houses now.
Right.
And that's a different situation for firemen to go into. And there is training out there. I've seen samples of it. Next one I see, I'm bringing to our fire department saying, have you guys got this yet? They very well might have that training already.
Okay.
Knowing Northampton's fire department, they very well might have that.
Is there specific equipment they're going to need for a project this big? I just want to make sure that budgeted.
Right.
My other big question, the benefit, and there are very few, to living near a landfill over the last 20 years has been that at night it's dark. Are there lights going into this project?
No.
So that leads me into my last one. The southern end of this is the most amazing critter corridor that Northampton has. An east-west corridor. We've got bear, we've even got moose, we've got fox families that live along there. I notice in these renderings there are no fences. Is that simply because they're not being shown, or is this not going to be fenced? Except for perhaps what's existing.
We have arrays that are fenced and those that aren't.
Okay.
There's an existing fencing infrastructure on the site.
Which apparently the animals are
just the landfill.
Just the landfill, right. Just for the landfill, there it's fenced. We would likely utilize that. We don't insist on putting another fence in if it's not really needed. On the ground mount portion, my guess is that the consensus would be from everyone that they would like to have that fenced. I think that we would probably fence that, but we would take into account, you know, whether that has any other, you know, kind of impacts, like you said. As I mentioned, we'll also be coordinating with Natural Heritage, and you know, that's something that we are very familiar with doing. That'll be part of what we work through with the permitting process.
And at this point, last question, I promise. At this point, the only access points are the two existing ones off of Glendale. Is that sort of the...
That's what we're thinking right now.
That's what we're working
on. Yeah.
Okay, you had your hand up?
I just wanted to ask another question about the net metering, and I understand there's been some kind of horse trading happening and that Charlie Baker has agreed to raise the cap, but he wants to put a limit on the number of years, and that's the way he's kind of making this happen. So I'm just wondering, if we're signing a 20-year lease, what does that mean in terms of the long term, if in fact there's a limit, a time limit on the raising of the cap?
So there's two bills in front of at the State House.
There's one that was passed through the Senate that increases the cap up to 1,600 megawatts, but doesn't distribute how that increase is going to benefit Massachusetts businesses, residents, municipalities across the Commonwealth. The governor's bill increased the cap to 1,600 megawatts as well, but provided some allocation of how that cap would be spread throughout the Commonwealth. The governor's bill also, actually both bills, secure net metering. Once you have net metering, you keep it generally for the life of the project. The governor's bill has put some time limits on that. That time limit right now is 20 years, after which a project that you're receiving a retail rate, so the full supply and delivery rate, would revert after 20 years to a wholesale rate, which would be a supply rate only. So that's exactly why in this contract between Ameresco and the city would be limited to 20 years with the opportunity or the option for extension, at which point the city governance would make a determination whether or not it was still economically beneficial to keep the asset on the site based on the economics. I was going to say, but that's all part of the consideration. You know, the expectation is, again, that net metering, there'll be some relief what it looks like and when it happens. I think the entire practitioning industry is hoping, and municipalities, quite frankly, because there's a huge backlog waiting for these projects to get net metering, is expecting it in the fall, and I think that's the governor's objective as well, to have some relief.
Plus, the federal cap is, I mean, the federal credits are supposed to expire at the end of 2016.
Correct.
So the shorter and shorter window for the Amorescos of the world to take advantage of those credits.
That's exactly
right. On projects they're trying to get built.
That's exactly right. So once we have a cap allocation, these guys will start of net metering. So we're guaranteed our net metering. The city is guaranteed its net metering. Ameresco will start to order equipment and start that construction. There's going to be a big push, as the mayor has said, for equipment and labor to get a lot of these projects built, because the federal investment tax credits go from, for commercial projects, go from 30% to 10% on January 1st, 2017. And for those of you in the audience who might be considering putting solar on your roofs, so you should think about it, because at the end of 2016, the residential credit, my understanding is, goes from 30% to zero.
That's
right. So would be the difference, roof versus ground?
It makes, well, so it's more of a difference of commercial versus residential. So residential consumers who want to do solar will lose that tax credit as of January 1st, 2017. The commercial sector, if you will, non-residential, that tax credit goes from 30% to 10%.
Because I have residents who want to put it on their ground, residential.
That would be fine, but they're going to lose their tax credit in January 2017. So for tax year 17. So they definitely, if they're thinking about it, you should have the focus on a 2016 installation. Unless the federal government changes that. And there's some discussion that there could be an extension, but, you know, next November.
President Sanders might.
Exactly. Next November is going to be a very busy season. I don't know how much attention it's going to get in Washington. So
we have a question here. Lined up.
This is for Mr. Valletta. I see panels are going to go in what we call the pit, correct?
No.
That's
no.
Not the pit.
No.
Close to the pit.
No. Not even close.
Well,
look
like
your
wallet.
Okay. They're all up
on top. We have a question back here.
Tom Barron, Ward 6, school committee candidate. So this question about the education component, I was thrilled to see that. So has there been discussion with the school committee, with the superintendent, about making sure that happens with all of our schools?
There is not yet, because we haven't got a contract signed.
I'm going to announce my background. I spent 10 years working for the Northeast Stable Energy Association as their education director, so working with teachers to help them understand renewable energy and clean transportation and stuff like that as part of the classroom. I plan on working with, once contract is signed, I'm going to work directly with Amoresco and introduce them to whoever we need to in the schools so that they're talking to the right teachers, the right principals, and try to work out what is going to be the most beneficial assistance that we can give to the schools to bring this project in.
The other thing I'd add to this, as a parent, I would love to get communication about that so we can bring
okay.
And
you know,
also, I just wrapped that up with Chris about Ryan Road School.
Yeah. Right, it would be great. And so, I also happen to know, this is a kind of a personal thing for me. When I worked at NESE, I wrote a curriculum called Energy Thinking that the Hitchcock Center adopted. And I've just heard recently, with no effort of my own, that Northampton Schools are going to be running that program for a few weeks. And it's a really, I think it's a very, very nice piece. And it might be a very nice tie-in to be able to kind of bring those two pieces together. So they're going to be running energy education in schools right now. It may be a way we can just tie that together.
I would also note, I'll just say quickly, I was involved with a project for two rooftop installations at schools, and it was one of the early projects, and Governor Patrick came in. It was a big press event, as you can imagine. And he literally took all the people taller, I almost got kicked out, taller than 5 feet, and you know, told us to all go away, and dove right in with the kids. The one thing that came out of that session was kids, high school kids, got a perspective that of where they could fit in this environment. Whether it's, you know, whether they're college bound and they want to pursue some, you know, some scientific path, or whether they're more trade focused and they want to get into the trades. But their kids really recognize an opportunity to participate in the sort of green jobs market from very, very different perspectives. And that was really exciting to watch, because there was like a, it was an epiphany, you know, there was a direction they could go into. They thought about electrical in a different way than wiring lights. And so that was something that I know, this is a tool in Chris's toolbox that he is very, very excited to implement with the schools.
And Joel, did you want to add anything to that? I jumped in, so.
No, I mean, it's, again, I kind of said a little piece earlier, that's fantastic to have you as a resource to coordinate with and with the city and with the school district. I think you know, we can do some good things.
And we have an array on JFK, and we also have a ground mounted system at Smith Vocational
right.
as well. So we have some but not in the schools. I'm just talking about schools. So
right.
so we do have some experience.
And a little demo project in Florida's fields.
Yes, and there will be as part of this. And this was not a gift at all, but as part of the contract that we had in our RFP, the buildings going on in Florence Field are designed to be net zero buildings. And the way the city was able to do that was, quite frankly, is that some of the, that this program, this working with Amoresco is actually going to channel money to that project so that we can put PV arrays on Florence Field, which means that that's going to be enough. To be tied in, you know, it's an opportunity for people to see it. You don't have to go out to the landfill to see the PVs. You can actually see an array at Florence Fields, so where kids are.
But Chris, they're going to be on the concession building.
They're going to be on the concession.
Not in the fields.
Right, the
they're
fields.
Going to be on the roof.
That's right.
Concession.
No, actually, we're going
to
have the baseball.
Hear from a bunch of neighbors tomorrow.
The only thing I want to point out, Chris, and to everyone, is that the system is monitored. Using a, you know, a web-based software and hardware, and that is basically it's on a, you know, it's at a certain IP address. So it's something that's actually accessible to anyone who's on the internet. And so a teacher could pull up and say, "What's the system at Glendale Road doing today?" They could actually see that interface. It's not enabled for the public for them to go in and, you know, turn the system on and off or anything like that, but they can go in and actually see the, you know, what it's doing that day. And so
the city can put that URL on its website. Each individual ward can have it, the individual websites. Teachers can put it on smart boards. There can be all kinds of contests going on to guess how much solar is being generated.
And I'm also going to mention, you know, we have two other arrays, James House and the one at Smith Vocational, both are online as well. You can have the students go up there and watch the clouds go by. Look, it's going over that building, and now it's over that building, the clouds are so.
I have a pretty ignorant question. In this leasing situation, Ameresco actually owns all of the hardware and all of the technology, so if you have inverter failure and that kind of thing, it's just replaced automatically. It's not, there's no, we don't incur any cost as a city, is that?
That's correct. In fact, this contract is sort of a payment performance.
If they don't generate electricity, they don't get paid. So it is absolutely in their financial interest to make sure that anything that breaks gets replaced or fixed immediately so that the system can generate.
What kind of lifespan do the industrial inverters have?
I'm going to let our expert here.
Right now the standard warranty is 10 years. We put in our model, our replacement at 10 years, but they can last more. I mean, they can last 15 or 20 years. Yep. As the panels.
And the panels maintain, you know, their efficiency is in year 25, it drops down to no less than about 80%, depending on the panels. But
do those panels get replaced if they're not efficient enough anymore? Or does the whole system get extended because it's not producing enough energy for whoever?
No, the panels, the manufacturers, they provide a guarantee for 25 years. The guarantee term said that after 25 years, the panels have to have at least 80% of the power. So that's the 0.5% degradation through the years. So if we notice through the website that there is something wrong with panels, we can check, and if there is a effect, the panel manufacturer has to provide them, but that's not common. It's really few cases that happen here and there, so it's not common that you have to replace any panels during the 20 years. Unless somebody breaks a panel, this is glass or something like that.
Or a defect.
Or really it's what is called an early detected defect on the panel. But they go through a rigorous process, and usually that doesn't happen.
I just wanted to speak to the property values in this project. Several years ago, I bought a piece of property that abuts landfill property because I foresaw this project coming. If it was going to remain a landfill, I wouldn't have even thought of buying that property. So it can work in a very positive way.
Questions winding down?
I want to thank you.
We actually do have one more, Marianne.
Oh, we got one more, sorry.
Right. She's a question generator.
And I'm sorry to be in this corner. I don't love that you being on camera. So she advised me that if I sat here, I wouldn't be. It's unfortunate that we have to give up our voices and images to the internet in order to participate in government. But that's another issue. Am I correct that the cement ballasts, are they called, are trucked in and that we won't be having concrete poured on site?
That's right. For the vast majority, these are precast ballast. These are all precast ballast blocks.
Okay.
I will say there could be a small amount of pouring for some small pads, the size of a small room.
The pads where we put the transformers,
okay.
I mean, there's a number of them. I think it's 5 or 6 only, where we poured up 10 by 15 feet. But it's only a few of them. It's just, maybe just a single truck in a day. Yep.
But there's only a certain type of equipment that can actually go on the landfill.
Right.
So one of those big, enormous cement trucks cannot.
Yeah, you cannot drive those on a landfill. Yeah.
Hey, I think we have questions.
That's it?
Go ahead.
I just want to thank you for being here this evening. And I do have to say that I went around with the flyers of this meeting around just strictly the perimeter of the landfill. And some of the people were like, I don't need to get because they're happy with us. And the reasons are is because of what residents went through before when that landfill was active. This is a no-brainer. I mean, we're going to be making and hopefully generating energy to our school buildings and municipal buildings. So I just wanted to let you know, I have not heard anybody say to me, no.
And again, I just want to point out that Ameresco's, they've said, will go through the permitting process.
That's right.
All local permitting, state permitting. This is not something that will happen absent, you know, local government and the state's oversight.
Could I just ask you a question? Who designed the one in East Hampton?
A company by the name of Borrego, and it was actually one of the earliest landfill projects that were that was done in the state. DEP learned a lot from that. I'm sorry?
Is it efficient over there? We don't hear anything about what it's been doing or...
It's my understanding it's operating...
That's the way solar is.
Yeah, it's going to be producing power.
Mayor Nuggets?
Are we ready to wrap up? Or
I believe so. Unless we have more questions, I think we're ready to wrap up.
So I just wanted to thank the panel again. I wanted to thank Councillor for helping us co-sponsor this. So where are we in the process? I have filed an order with the City Council basically asking for the City Council's authorization to enter into this lease for 20 years and the power purchasing agreement. So that's going to go to the City Council on Thursday for a first reading. A second reading that's required would happen later on in October, October 15th. It's been mentioned earlier, we do have zoning regulations in place for solar. So there will be a special, not a special permit required, but a site plan.
There'll be a site
plan. A site plan review by the planning board for a project like this, because it is allowed by right on landfills and in other areas. And then there's all the other DEP regulations and all the other environmental reviews that will have to happen. So there will be other public access points. And obviously you can contact my office, Councilor LaBarge, any of the other councilors with any questions that you have in the intervening time. Ameresco's proposal is up on our website, and we're going to be putting this presentation up there as well so that people can find that if they want to review it again. So thank you all for coming out, and again, stay tuned for more information as we move through the process. And thanks again to all of you for being here.
Thank you.